Laudator Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ. A warm welcome to all of you to this live broadcast coming to you from St. Peter's Basilica for the Ordinary Public Consistory for the creation of new cardinals. Pope Francis, during this ceremony, will be elevating 13 men to the honorary position of cardinal. As you can see, they are beginning to process into the basilica, followed by His Holiness Pope Francis. A warm welcome to all of you joining us, however you happen to be participating, wherever you are participating throughout the world. Many of you joining us through various Vatican media channels, perhaps through the Vatican News web portal and app or the YouTube channel, as well as all of you joining us through television, through those television networks making this possible. A thank you to them as well. You're joining us through Catholic Faith Network, Shalom World TV, Salt and Light TV, EWTN and Catholic TV, and many, many more are joining through radio and internet throughout the world. We see our Holy Father now in prayer. Before the high altar under which the earthly remains of St. Peter the Apostle once again, we are taking part in a consistory, an ordinary consistory. It's public for the creation of new cardinals. The name consistory comes from the Latin consistorium, which means a place of assembly, because the Latin verb consistere means literally to stand together. These ecclesial assemblies began about the 11th century, giving the Pope regular opportunities to seek advice from his most trusted counselors, that is the cardinals. Here we see two of the cardinal-elect. Today, the ceremony in which the Pope will create the new cardinals consists of several phases. It is not a liturgy, but there will be the reading of a gospel, and the Holy Father will deliver a discourse. The cardinals will recite an oath, and then they will each receive the beretta, which is a red hat, the cardinalatial ring, and a titular church will be assigned to them here in Rome. This consistory was announced after reciting the Angelus on Sunday, September 1st, and Pope Francis surprised everyone announcing that the consistory would be held today on October the 5th. And he said that the places where these new cardinals come from express the missionary vocation of the Church. We now prepare for the beginning of this ceremony.
Grazia vobis et pax a Deo Padre nostro e Domino Jesu Christo.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
We have now entered into the consistory. And now we will have a greeting from Cardinal-to-be Miguel Angel Ayuso, Most Holy Father, we are grateful to you for having chosen us from all parts of the world to share your ministry as Bishop of Rome with you in a particular way for the good of all the holy faithful people of God. We are very much aware that you have assigned to us a particular title of communion with the Church of Rome. This is a call from the Lord to become even more close collaborators with Peter and under Peter.
Ricordandoci quanto scritto nel Vangelo di Luca, chiunque si esalta sarà umiliato.
Recalling what is written in the Gospel of Luke, whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. We are aware that each ecclesial vocation is above all a service to the brothers and sisters and to the Church herself.
La necessità di percorrere la via dell'umiltà.
Jesus always shows us the need to follow the way of humility and of a gratuitousness without end.
Vorrei qui menzionare, Santo Padre, per descrivere i sentimenti che noi abbiamo nel cuore, quanto disse il Beato Cardinale.
In order to express the feelings we have in our hearts, I would like to mention something that Blessed Cardinal Marcello Spinola, Archbishop of Seville, who was known as the Mendicant Bishop, said.
Quando gli portarono la notizia della sua creazione a cardinale, così si espresse. Quando ritornerete a Roma, dite al Padre Santo che io.
In 1905, when they brought him the news that he was going to be made a cardinal, he said this: when you return to Rome, tell the Holy Father that I do not know how to do great things, but I am ready to sacrifice myself. So, as I have sacrificed myself for the faithful entrusted to me, so I will sacrifice myself for the Church and for the Pope.
Servizio della Santa Sede, Ministero Pastorale. Segno eloquente dell'universalità della Chiesa.
We come from different ecclesial experiences, service to the Holy See and pastoral ministry. This is an eloquent sign of the universality of the Church in its diverse expressions of the one faith. Holy Father, allow me to say to you that it is a bit of a consistory of religious men. In fact, there are quite a few of us who belong to religious orders who are also distinguished by their missionary character.
Nel quale diede annuncio di questo concistoro, Vostra Santità disse, la loro provenienza.
During the Angelus of this past September 1st, in which you announced this consistory, Your Holiness said, where they come from expresses the missionary vocation of the Church, who continues to proclaim the merciful love of God to all men and women on the earth.
Di questo concistoro, con I 100 anni dalla lettera apostolica Maximum Illud di Papa Benedetto XV.
Furthermore, it touches me that this consistory concludes with the 100th anniversary of the Apostolic Letter Maximum Illud of Pope Benedict XV. To celebrate this anniversary, you, Holy Father, wanted that this month of October be declared an extraordinary missionary month, indicating as its theme, baptized and sent, the Church of Christ in mission to the world. In fact, the missionary church, called to make the proclamation of the Risen One resound, opens itself to an encounter and to dialogue with the men and women of our time. It is a church that wants to testify to the mercy of God toward all those who suffer because of violence and injustice. Thus, Pope St. Paul VI in the encyclical Ecclesiam Suam said, the Church must enter into dialogue with the world in which it lives. It has something to say, a message to give, a communication to make.
Lei, Santo Padre, con la sua instancabile opera, ci ha più volte invitato ad essere.
You, Holy Father, with your untiring work, have invited us many times to be a church that goes out, to go to the existential peripheries, to walk along the path of ecumenical and interreligious dialogue.
Desideriamo adoperarci, assieme a vostra santità, ad avviare processi e non ad occupare spazi.
We want to strive together with your holiness to initiate processes and not occupy space, to build a new world where fraternity, peace, and common living together might reign.
Chiediamo a nostro Signore che ci doni uno sguardo e un cuore compassionevoli, come il buon samaritano.
We ask our Lord to give us the capacity of having compassionate eyes and hearts, like the Good Samaritan, who compassionately bends down over his suffering neighbor, we would like to alleviate the wounds of this world and heal the sick. There is a balm that we can use. It is made of the value of fraternity, founded on our common origin in God, and from which is derived the inviolable dignity of each person, the culture of inclusion, of dialogue in favor of peace, which is lacking in so many places in the world, and for a loving respect for creation.
Padre Santo, nel rinnovarle ancora il nostro grazie, desideriamo assicurarle la nostra.
Holy Father, in renewing our gratitude once again, we wish to assure you of our faithful and sincere collaboration and the certainty that you will find us near and ready to sustain you in the mission that our Lord has entrusted to you. Above all, we promise you our constant prayer, entrusting your person and your ministry to the maternal protection of the Virgin Mary, Mother of Mercy, and Mother of the Church, and to the intercession of St. Francis of Assisi, whose feast we solemnly celebrated yesterday, and which reminds us that the Christian has one sole weapon, humble faith and concrete, fraternal, compassionate love for all of creation. Thank you, Holy Father. The greeting of Monsignor or Bishop Miguel Ángel Ayuso. He is the president of the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue, giving the Holy Father the embrace of peace. The 13 cardinals who are being elevated, we see them sitting here in the front. Many other members of the College of Cardinals are also present here. And we prepare to continue with the opening prayer.
Oremos. Domine Deus, Pater Gloriae, Fons Bonorum, Vilicet Ecclesiam Tuam Toto Orbe.
Lord God, Father of glory, source of all that is good, who unceasingly enrich your Church throughout the world with an abundance of gifts, yet with still greater benevolence, watch over the see of Blessed Peter the Apostle, which you have set above all others. In your providence, grant that I, your servant, may carry out wisely the office entrusted to me in the certain knowledge that you will bestow upon the Universal Church all those things you have promised her, to whose benefit all is directed.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
The proclamation of the Gospel this evening is taken from the Gospel according to Mark.
Ascoltate la parola del Signore dal Vangelo secondo Marco. In quel tempo gli apostoli si riunirono attorno a Gesù e gli riferirono tutto quello che avevano fatto e quello che avevano insegnato.
At that time the apostles joined Jesus again and told him all they had done and taught. Then Jesus said to them, "You must come away to some lonely place all by yourselves and rest for a while." For there were so many coming and going that the apostles had not even time to eat. So they went off in a boat to a lonely place where they could be by themselves. But people saw them going, and many could guess where. And from every town, they all hurried to the place on foot and reached it before them. So he stepped ashore. He saw a large crowd, and he took pity on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he set himself to teach them at some length. But now it was getting very late, and his disciples came up to him and said, "This is a lonely place, and it is getting very late. So send them away, and they can go to the farms and villages around about to buy themselves something to eat." And Jesus replied, "Give them something yourselves to eat." Here we see some of the dignitaries who have come in recognition of several of the cardinals from the countries. We will now hear our Holy Father pronounce his discourse prepared specifically for this particular consistory. Here we see several of the men who are being elevated today.
Al centro del racconto evangelico che abbiamo ascoltato c'è la compassione di Gesù. Compassione, parola chiave del Vangelo.
At the heart of the Gospel we have just heard is the compassion of Jesus. Compassion is a key word in the Gospel. It is written in Christ's heart. It is forever written in the heart of God. In the Gospels, we often see Jesus' compassion for those who are suffering. The more we read, the more we contemplate, the more we come to realize that the Lord's compassion is not an occasional, sporadic emotion, but is steadfast and indeed seems to be the attitude of his heart in which God's mercy is made incarnate.
Quando Gesù incominciò ad andare per la Galilea predicando e scacciando I demoni, venne da lui un lebbroso.
Mark, for example, tells us that when Jesus first passed through Galilee preaching and casting out demons, a leper came to him begging him, and kneeling said to him, "If you choose, you can make me clean." moved with compassion. Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, I do will it. Be made clean. In this gesture and with these words, we see the mission of Jesus, the Redeemer of mankind. He is a compassionate Redeemer. He incarnates God's will to purify men and women afflicted by the scourge of sin. He is the outstretched hand of God who touches our sickly flesh and accomplishes this work by bridging the chasm of separation. Jesus goes out in search of the outcast, those without hope, people like the man paralyzed for 38 years who lay beside the pool of Bethsaida, waiting in vain for someone to bring him to the waters.
Non è spuntata a un certo punto della storia della salvezza, no, è sempre stata in Dio.
This compassion did not suddenly appear at one moment in the history of salvation. No, it was always there in God, impressed on his paternal heart. We see it in the account of the calling of Moses when God spoke from the burning bush and said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry. Indeed, I know their sufferings. This is the compassion of a father. God's love for his people is drenched with compassion to the extent that in this covenant relationship, what is divine is compassionate, while, sad to say, it appears that what is human is so often lacking in compassion. God himself says so. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, Israel? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. For I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. From the book of the prophet Hosea. Jesus' disciples often show themselves lacking compassion, as in this case, when they are faced with the problem of having to feed the crowds. In effect, they say, let them worry about it themselves. This is a common attitude among us human beings, even those of us who are religious persons, or even religious professionals. We wash our hands. The position we occupy is not enough to make us compassionate, as we see in the conduct of the priest and Levite, who, seeing a dying man on the side of the road, passed to the other side. They would have thought, it's not up to me. There's always some excuse, some justification to look the other way. Sometimes these justifications are even codified, regulated, and give rise to institutional disregard, as was the case with lepers. Of course, they have to keep their distance. That's the right thing to do, and that's how we think. This all too often attitude also generates structures lacking compassion.
A questo punto possiamo domandarci, siamo coscienti noi per primi di essere stati oggetto della compassione di Dio?
At this point we can ask ourselves, are we aware, we in the first place, of having been the object of God's compassion? In a particular way I ask this of you, Brother Cardinals, and those about to become Cardinals. Do you have a lively awareness of having always been preceded and accompanied by His mercy? This awareness was always present in the Immaculate Heart of the Virgin Mary. who praises God as her Savior, for he looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. I find it helpful to see myself reflected in the passage of Ezekiel chapter 16 that speaks of God's love for Jerusalem. It concludes with the words, "I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall know that I am the Lord, in order that you may remember and be confounded, and never open your mouth again because of your shame, when I forgive you all that you have done." Or again in that other prophecy of Hosea, "I will bring her to the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. There she shall respond as in the days of her youth, as at the time when she came out of the land of Egypt." We can ask ourselves, do I feel deep within me, deep within myself, God's compassion, the certainty that I am a son of compassion? Do we have a lively awareness of that compassion that God feels for us? It's not something optional or a kind of evangelical counsel. No. It's essential. Unless I feel that I am the object of God's compassion, I can never understand His love. This is not a reality that can be explained. Either I feel it or I don't. If I don't feel it, how can I share it, communicate it, bear witness to it, give it to others? Concretely, am I compassionate toward this bishop or priest, or do I constantly tear others down by my attitude of condemnation, of indifference, of always looking away, and in reality, washing my hands?
Da questa consapevolezza viva dipende per tutti voi, noi, la capacità di essere leale.
The lively awareness also depends on your ability to be loyal in your own ministry. This also holds true for you, brother cardinals. The readiness of a cardinal, I was thinking of you when I wrote the letter on the 1st of September. That is, the readiness of a cardinal to shed his own blood.
In questa coscienza di aver ricevuto compassione e nella capacità di avere compassione.
That readiness is secure if it is rooted in the awareness of having been shown compassion and in the ability to show compassion in turn. Otherwise, one cannot be loyal. So many disloyal actions on the part of ecclesiastics are born from the lack of a sense of having been shown compassion and the habit of turning away. The habit of indifference. Today, let us implore, through the intercession of the Apostle Peter, the grace to have a compassionate heart in order to be the witness of the one who has looked with favor upon us, who looked on us with mercy, who chose us, consecrated us, and sent us to bring to everyone his gospel of salvation. The words of the Holy Father to these 13 brothers of his, whom he will be elevating to the rank of cardinal, as we heard one of the things to which they are called is that of being so faithful to Christ that they would be willing to shed their blood. And this is where the color red comes from, that is worn by cardinals in the church. Many of these men, as we heard, come from missionary congregations. Three are Jesuits, one is a Comboni missionary, there's one Capuchin Franciscan, one Salesian of Don Bosco, there's one White Father, and one poor servant of divine providence. 10 of the cardinals, or the men about to be cardinals, will be able to participate in an eventual conclave, should that be necessary, and 3 are over the age of 80, and therefore will not participate ever in electing a pope, should that be necessary. The origins of these men: North America, Central America, Africa, Europe and Asia, Indonesia, Morocco, Cuba, Guatemala, Angola, Luxembourg, as we see coming definitely from the Church Universal. We begin now with the rite for the creation of new cardinals, with the Pope praying. Dear brothers and sisters, we are about to carry out an agreeable and solemn task of our sacred ministry. It chiefly concerns the Church of Rome, but it also affects the entire ecclesial community. We will call certain of our brethren to enter the College of Cardinals so that they may be united to the chair of Peter by a closer bond in our apostolic ministry. Having been invested with the sacred purple, they are to be fearless witnesses to Christ and his gospel in the city of Rome and in faraway regions. Therefore, by the authority of Almighty God, of Saints Peter and Paul and our own, we create and solemnly proclaim cardinals of Holy Roman Church these brethren of ours.
Episcopum titulo Lupercenensem, President Pontifici Consili pro Dialogo Interreligioso.
President of the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue. José Tolentino,
Archivista e Bibliotecario in Santa Romana Ecclesia.
He's from Portugal, Librarian for the Holy Roman Church, the Archbishop of Jakarta,
Joanna Caritate Garcia Rodriguez,
Archbishop of San Cristobal de Havana in Cuba, Archbishop of Kinshasa,
Claudium Hollerich, Archbishop Luxemburgensem,
Archbishop of Luxembourg,
Leonilium Ramazzini Meri, Episcopum,
Bishop of Huehuetenango in Guatemala,
Archbishop Bolognese,
Archbishop of Bologna in Italy,
Archbishop
of Rabat in Morocco,
Michael M. Cherny, Archbishop Titulo Beneventense,
the Undersecretary of the Section Migrants and Refugees in the Vatican,
ad Podicasterium ad Integram Humanam Progressionem Favendam. Michael M. Aloysium Fitzgerald, Archbishop,
the former Apostolic Nuncio of Egypt, Archbishop Emeritus of Kaunas in Lithuania,
Eugenium Dal Corso,
Archbishop Emeritus of Benguela in Angola.
Escribo preteri ad ordinem cardinalum diaconorum pertenebum Michelangelus Ayuso Vixot, Josephus Tolentinus Calasa de Mendoza, Michael Cerny, and Michael Aloysius Fitzgerald.
He's saying which ones are in the cardinal diaconate.
Requiem relicos vero omnes adornes pertinere volumus cardinalium presbyterorum.
And now the list of those who are cardinal priests, the rest whom he did not mention.
Fratres carissime, Fidem vestram in Deum.
And now we move to the profession of faith. Dear brothers, in the presence of the holy people of God, profess now your faith in the triune God and your fidelity to the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
Credo in Deum Patrem omnipotentem, Creatorem celi et terre, et in Iesum Christum, filium eius unicum, Dominum nostrum, qui conceptus est de Spiritus Santo, natus ex Maria Virgine, passus sub Pontio Pilato, crucifixus mortus et sepultus, descendit ad inferos, tertia die resurrexit a mortuis, ascendit ad celos, sedet ad dexteram Dei Patris Omnipotentis, inde venturus est judicare vivos et mortuos. Credo in Spiritum Sanctum, Sanctam Ecclesiam Catholicam, Santorum Communionem, remissionem peccatorum, carnis resurrectionem, vitam aeternam. Amen.
They have just finished proclaiming the Apostles' Creed as their act of faith, and now the oath of fidelity.
Sante Romane Ecclesiae, Cardinalis adjusso
Cardinal,
promitto et
juro, Cardinal of Holy Roman Church, promise and swear. From this day forth, as long as I live, to remain faithful to Christ and his gospel, constantly obedient to the Holy Apostolic Roman Church, to Blessed Peter in the person of Francis,
legitimeque electis, constanter fore,
and his canonically elected successors, always to remain in communion with the Catholic Church, in my words and actions, not to make known to anyone matters entrusted to me in confidence,
numquam in ecclesiae damnum,
the disclosure of which could bring damage or dishonor to Holy Church, to carry out diligently and faithfully
et fidelitate onera explere
the duties
quibus teneor erga ecclesiam,
to which I am called in my service to the Church,
exercendum secundum iuris
according to the norms
vocatus sum,
laid down by law.
Me Deus omnipotens,
so help me,
adiuvet.
God. The cardinals have just professed their faith in God, and now we move to the imposition of the beretta, the giving of the ring, and the assigning of the title or deanery. To the glory of Almighty God and the honor of the Apostolic See, receive the scarlet beretta as a sign of the dignity of the cardinalate, signifying your readiness to act with courage, even to the shedding of your blood, for the increase of the Christian faith, for the peace and tranquility of the people of God, and for the freedom and growth of Holy Roman Church. The cardinals now go up one by one. First, Miguel Ángel Ayuso, President of the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue from Spain, a Cambone missionary. He will now also receive the ring. Receive the ring from the hands of Peter and know that your love for the Church is strengthened by the love of the Prince of the Apostles. To the honor of Almighty God and of Saints Peter and Paul, we entrust you with the title Saint Jerome in Via Giulia, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This process will now be repeated. The embrace of peace. Bishop Ayuso, or Cardinal now Ayuso, was consecrated bishop in 2016. Jose Tolentino Mendoza, archivist and librarian of the Holy Roman Church from Portugal.
Acipeanulum de Manu Petri, et nobilis directione principis apostolorum, direction tua in ecclesia in Rovara. Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, et Santorum Apostolum Petri et Pauli, tibi comitimus diaconia Sancti Hieronymi a Caritate in Via Iulia, in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
He is a cardinal deacon, and his titular church is that of Saints Dominic and Sextus. Now we have Archbishop Ignatius Suharjo Harjodmojo from Jakarta, originally from Java, nominated Archbishop of Semarang in 1997, and became Archbishop of Jakarta in 2010.
Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, ex Santorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli, tibi comitimus diaconiam Spiritus Sancti ad Ferratellam.
His titular church is the Holy Spirit in Ferratella. This particular cardinal, now the Archbishop of Jakarta, is a current member of the Congregation for the Evangelization of Peoples and is the president of the Episcopal Conference in Indonesia. Here we have Juan de la Caridad Garcia Rodriguez from Havana, Cuba.
Acipeanorum de Manu Petri, et nobilis directione principis apostolorum, directionem tuam et ecclesiam roborari. Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, ex Santorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli, tibi comitimus titulum Santorum Aquile et Presile, in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
He's being created a cardinal priest, and his titular church, Saints Aquila and Priscilla. Now Archbishop Fridolin Ambongo Besungu from Kinshasa, a Capuchin Franciscan. He's also vice president of the National Episcopal Conference of the Congo. And he became the Archbishop of Kinshasa in 2018.
Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, ex Santorum Apostolorum Tuorum, Petri et Pauli, tibi comitimus titulum Sancti Gabrielis Arcangeli ad aquam transversam. In nomine Patris et Filii Spiritus Sancti.
And Cardinal Ambongo Besungo assumes the title of Cardinal Priest, and his titular church, Saint Gabriel the Archangel at Acqua Traversa. Now we have Archbishop Jean-Claude Hollerich, the Archbishop of Luxembourg, a Jesuit who spent many years in Japan. And Pope Benedict XVI nominated him Archbishop of Luxembourg in 2011.
Et nobilis directione principis apostolorum, directionem tuam erga ecclesia in roborari. Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, ex Santorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli, tibi comitimus titulum Sancti Ioannis Chrysostomi in regione Vulgo Monte Sacro Alto. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus.
Cardinal Hollerich, also a cardinal priest, a titular church is Saint John Chrysostom's at Monte Sacro Alto. Now Bishop Alvaro Ramazzini Imeri, Archbishop of Huehuetenango in Guatemala. He presides over the Commission for Social Communication and the Pastoral Penitentiary Commission for the Episcopal Conference. He was nominated bishop in
2012. Ad honorem Dei omnipotentis et sanctorum apostolorum Petri et Pauli, tibi cum intimus titulum Sancti Ioannis Evangelisti Spinacetto, in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
Cardinal Ramazzini Emeri, a cardinal priest with the titular church St. John the Evangelist at Spinacetto. Now we have Archbishop Matteo Zuppi, the Archbishop of Bologna, born in Rome, ordained for the Diocese of Palestrina. He became an auxiliary bishop of Rome in 2012. And then in 2015, Pope Francis nominated him the Metropolitan Archbishop of Bologna, receiving the Beretta, the ring, and his titular church.
Direzione tua nella Ecclesia Roborari. Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, et Sanctorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli, divi cum intimus titulum Sancti Egidi trans Tiberin. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
Cardinal Zuppi is a cardinal priest with the titular church of Saint Egidio, in Trastevere, or he has quite a connection with the Saint Egidio community. It's beautiful that he has Saint Egidio as his titular church. Now, Archbishop Cristobal Lopez Romero, a Salesian. Oh no, it looks like Michael Czerny. No, it is Lopez Romero, Archbishop of Rabat from Spain, a Salesian.
Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis et Sanctorum Apostolorum Petri et
Pauli. He's been a missionary in Paraguay, Bolivia, Morocco, and then back in Spain. He became the Archbishop of Morocco, of Rabat in Morocco in 2017. His titular church, Saint Leo I, and he too is a cardinal priest. Now, Bishop or Father Czerny, he was ordained a bishop yesterday, Undersecretary of the Migrants and Refugee Section. Originally from the Czech Republic, he entered the Society of Jesus in Canada. He then went to San Salvador and also in Africa.
Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, Ex Sanctorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli, divi comitimus diaconiam Sancti Michaelis Arcangeli, in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
He was a member of the Synod of Bishops on Young People last year, and this year for the Special Synod on the Amazon is one of the special secretaries. Cardinal Czerny, a cardinal deacon, his titular church is St. Michael the Archangel. All of the previous cardinals, cardinal electors, the next three are not cardinal electors, all over the age of 80. Archbishop Michael Lewis Fitzgerald, former apostolic nuncio of Egypt, born in Walsall, entered the Society of the Missionaries of Africa, or the White Fathers.
Direzionem tuam ergan ecclesiam roborari. Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, ex Sanctorum Apostolorum Petri et Pauli, divi comitimus diaconiam Sancte Maria in portico, in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus.
He was the president of the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue before being named the Apostolic Nuncio in Egypt. He is a cardinal deacon, and his titular church is Santa Maria in Portico. Archbishop Emeritus Sigitas Tamkevičius of Kaunas in Lithuania, ordained a diocesan priest and then entered the Society of Jesus.
Manum de manu Petri, et nobis, direzione principis apostolorum, direzione tuam era ecclesia in roborari. Ad honorem Dei Omnipotentis, ex Sanctorum Apostolorum Petri Pauli, divi comitimus titulum Sancte Angelae Merici,
He was arrested in 1983 for anti-Soviet propaganda. He spent 10 years in a prison work camp, and then he was exiled to Siberia and released in 88. He then became the Archbishop of Kaunas and retired in 2015, having reached the age limit. He is a cardinal priest, and his titular church is St. Angela Merici. The last Bishop Eugenio Dal Corso, Bishop Emeritus of Benguela in Angola, born in the Italian province of Verona, and he became a missionary.
Arcipiano de Manu Petri, et nobilis directione principis apostolorum, directione tua nere ecclesia in rogorari. Ad honorem Dei Onipotentis, ex antorum apostolorum Petri e Pauli, tibi comitimus titulum Sante Anastasie. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus.
Argentina was his first destination, where he remained for 11 years, until his transfer to Luanda in Angola, where he dedicated himself to the weakest of the populations. He became Bishop of Benguela in 2008, where he remained until he resigned due to having reached the age limit. He is a cardinal priest, and his titular church is Saint Anastasia. As we can see, the cardinals now making their way, greeting their fellow cardinals in the College of Cardinals. Antiphon now being proclaimed by the choir. Go out to the whole world, says the Lord. Proclaim the good news to all creation. The cardinals of the Holy Roman Church make up what we call a college, College of Cardinals. And one of their preeminent tasks, as we know, is that of electing the Roman pontiff. They also assist the Roman pontiff either collegially when they're convoked in a consistory, or individually when they help the Roman pontiff through various offices or in the care of particular churches. There are three orders. There's the cardinal deacon, the cardinal priest, and cardinal bishop. The reason why they are given a titular church in Rome is due to history. The Synod of Rome originally made up of priests and the bishops from the surrounding sees were the Pope's counselors, and as the Roman see became more universal in nature, the capacity of being a counselor to the Pope was granted to men who were bishops of primary sees throughout Europe. But in order to maintain a specific tie with the church in Rome, because they were counselors to the Bishop of Rome, the custom began of giving them a titular church. The cardinals who have been assigned a titular church are to promote the good of these churches. For cardinal bishops, they're given one of these surrounding Roman dioceses as in titular church instead of a titular church. So they offer counsel and patronage to the church or the diocese that they have been assigned, but they have no power of governance over them. They're not to intervene in any way in the matters pertaining to the administration of their goods or in any discipline or service. Prior to today's consistory, there were 212 members in the College of Cardinals, 118 of whom were electors. Today, 10 are being added to the number of cardinals who will be eligible to elect a pope, should that become necessary in a conclave. As we heard, the cardinals especially assist the Pope through collegial action in consistories gathered by order of the Roman Pontiff who presides over the consistories, whether extraordinary or ordinary. There are two types of ordinary consistories, those for the creation of new cardinals and those for the creation of saints. There are also extraordinary consistories, which are convened when particular needs of the church need to be discussed or treatment of more grave matters. Extraordinary consistories are never public, but the two ordinary types of consistories are. They don't take place within the liturgy of the Eucharist, but they follow a type of ritual. There are times when a pope has created a cardinal but does not make that public. And should that happen, the one promoted is not bound by the duty of cardinal. It's only after his name has been made public that he assumes the rights and duties of a cardinal. And there will be one cardinal who will be canonized on Sunday, October 13th. That is Cardinal John Henry Newman, as we know, a convert from the Anglican tradition. The cardinals continue to greet one another. The one person who needed to be ordained a bishop prior to this consistory, Father, he was former Michael Czerny. It was John the 23rd who mandated that cardinals be ordained bishop prior to becoming cardinal. Prior to that, that was not always the case. And there are still some times for those who are created cardinals over the age limit that it is possible they receive a dispensation from that law.
Oh,
Dicamus nunc omnes orationem quam Christus, tanquam exemplar, omnis orationes nobis dedit.
Our Holy Father now inviting us to pray the Lord's Prayer.
O
God, who always walk in the paths of mercy and truth, renew the gifts that you have bestowed and mercifully grant by your grace what human weakness cannot attain, namely that these servants of yours, by constantly building up your church, may shine forth with integrity of faith and purity of mind. Now we prepare ourselves for the final blessing.
Domino vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sit nomen Domini benedictum.
Ex hoc nunque tusque in saeculum.
Aetorium nostrum in nomine Domini.
Qui fecit caelum et terra.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
And our Holy Father now going over to the statue of Our Lady for the singing of the Salve Regina.
Salve.
The procession now taking leave of the altar. Here at the conclusion of the ordinary public consistory, in which 13 new cardinals have been made by Pope Francis. He is now going down the aisle. as we heard the commitment that these men have been asked to take by the Holy Father is very grave, and these men may be asked at a certain point to elect a successor of Peter, vicar of Christ on earth. We keep these men in our prayers. Many of them were just as surprised to hear the news of their being appointed cardinals by Pope Francis on September 1st. They were not contacted ahead of time. Here we see them going down the aisle. We see flags from various nations. Some of you may be from territories where these cardinals are ministering. Many of these cardinals will be participating in the opening mass of the Special Assembly of the Synod of Bishops on the Pan-Amazon region, which is tomorrow, being celebrated on the 27th Sunday in Ordinary Time. We now end this live broadcast of the Ordinary Public Consistory for the creation of new cardinals, in which Pope Francis elevated 13 bishops to the rank of cardinal. You can find full coverage of today's liturgy and other Vatican and world news. That's found at the Vatican News web portal, www.vaticannews.va, but also on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. We hope you join us tomorrow for the opening mass for the Special Assembly of the Synod of Bishops on the Pan-Amazon region. On behalf of Vatican Media, I'm Sister Bernadette. It's been a pleasure providing you with the English language texts and translations. I'd also like to thank the production staff here in studio, but most of all for all of you for taking time to join us today. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ.